Entity relationship diagrams are a way to represent different things, both within a process and related to it. Apart from helping to visualize systems, one of the other common uses for entity relationship diagrams is the visualization of databases, where they are commonly used to show how different tables in the database relate to each other. If you have ever used entity relationship diagrams in this way, a lot of the content in this section will likely be quite familiar to you. Some important points to make at this point are the fact that entity relationship diagrams don't have any influence over how data is moved around a system. The point of the diagram is only to represent the fact that data does indeed move around the system. Entity relationship diagrams also respect some of the high-level business rules relating to data which moves through the system, such as the fact that in travel agents, one person can schedule many holidays, as well as the fact that a person must book at least one holiday in order to be considered a customer. Entity relationship diagrams technically consist of just two symbols, entities and relationships. Entities are represented by a rectangle with rounded corners, while relationships are represented by various lines. Rather than trying to explain each different type of relationship and then showing them in action, we will look at the relationships in context. This is what a very basic entity relationship diagram looks like. Specifically, this diagram represents a game of golf. If you have ever played golf, you will know that one game consists of many holes, and if you play a hole in the game of golf, you take many shots to get the ball from the tee to the hole. Because you know that there is some sort of relationship between a hole and a game of golf, you can draw a line between them. The same goes for the holes and the shots. You know that there is some kind of relationship, so you can draw a line between them too. Now think about the wording of the sentences. There are many holes in one game of golf. There are many shots in one hole. We know that there are many of something and one of something else on each occasion. And in this relationship, and this is the relationship that the two entities have to one another. It's also called a one-to-many relationship. We represent this type of relationship on an entity relationship diagram by adding a crow's foot to the line at the end next to the thing that there are many of. If there is such thing as a one-to-many relationship, it stands to reason that there should also be one-to-one relationships. Let's use our game of golf diagram. For every shot you play, you are only going to actually use one golf club. And because there are as many shots as there are golf clubs used, we don't need to add any crow's feet to that relationship. It's one to one. Before we look at many to many relationships, you can see that we're quickly running out of space in our diagram. So we should do some house cleaning to free up some space. The biggest space hog is the fact that we have these duplicates of each of the entities. We can clean these up by redirecting our relationships to use just one instance of each entity like this. This represents the exact same concept as we've already discussed, but with much less wasted space. I did mention that many-to-many relationships also exist. This can be true in the real world, but entity relationship diagrams technically don't allow them. Entity relationship diagrams aficionados will tell you that they are almost certainly looking at the problem in the wrong way if you think you need to use a many-to-many relationship. Let's imagine that instead of the one-to-one relationship we have between shot and club here, we had a many-to-many relationship. After all, it's not uncommon for a golfer to consider multiple different clubs from his bag before taking a shot. At the same time, there's nothing wrong with using the same club for multiple shots. So what we do is to add another entity into the middle of the many-to-many relationship, called a link entity. In our example, we can call this entity something like shot club, symbolising the fact that even though we have many clubs available to us when we played the shot, and we may have even tried a few of them out, this was the club that we used to play the shot. This trick works with almost any many-to-many relationship. Just combine the names of the two entities in question. Another important part of the relationship is the fact that relationships must be described in the form of a few words, which are added to each end of the relationship line. The description only needs to be very brief. 3 words is towards the longer end of the scale. 1 word will often be enough. The ultimate idea is that you should be able to describe the relationship along the lines of one game of golf consists of many holes. Many holes make one game of golf. You should be able to form sentences from any entity to any other entity on the diagram using only words contained on the diagram itself, which means that you need to describe each relationship in both directions, which is why compacting your diagram, as we did earlier, is so important. So before we move on, let's review the symbols within an entity relationship diagram. We have entities, which are rectangles with rounded corners. These can literally be anything which is relevant in the context of your diagram. People, animals, names, teams, companies, you name it. Entities are then connected together with relationship lines. And the relationships possible are one-to-one, one-to-many, and many-to-many. These are represented by adding crow's feet to the ends of the line, of which there are many of. If you ever encounter many-to-many relationship, you should put a link entity in the diagram to split the relationship into 2 one-to-many relationships. Finally, each relationship must have a description at each end, which can be used to form a sentence which describes the relationship in plain English. Now let's have a look at attributes. Attributes, simply put, are things that an entity has. A department in a company will have a manager. It may have its own unique department number. It may be located at a specific place. Or it may have any other number of attributes depending on the company. In this style of diagram, we will just add the attributes to the diagram itself in the form of a bulleted list underneath the entity to which they relate. But if your diagram is squashed together, you might want to add a line around them to make it obvious which entity they relate to. If you have worked on databases in the past, you'll probably see that the link entities would represent tables in the database, while the attributes represent the columns in each table. We can go a step further though, and if you've used databases before, you might be familiar with the idea of keys. Keys are ways which we can highlight what data is important, and give some detail about how different attributes are connected to each other between different entities or tables. The first type of key you should know about is called the primary key. Primary keys are basically unique identifiers, whether it's a student ID, an employee number, or in this case a department ID. Having unique IDs gives us the ability to refer to specific things later on, knowing that we are actually referring to the thing we wanted to refer to. In big companies, for example, it's common to have 2 people with the same name, so having this unique number allows us to know which one is which easily. In our diagram, we're going to represent the primary key by underlining it. The second type of key that you need to know about is called a foreign key. A foreign key is actually a primary key from another entity, and this is what allows us to have one-to-many relationships. In this example, we have many employees working in one department. So if you said that the Human Resources Department was a Department 1, you could then tell everyone who worked for Human Resources that they worked in Department 1. If you had a sales team and the sales team was number 8, you would know that the people who worked in the sales department worked in Department 8. The people working in each of those departments would have the attribute of working in those specific departments, so you would add those details to the employee element. In our diagram, we will indicate that department ID in the student entity is a foreign key by adding an asterisk to the end of the attribute's name. It's important that the attributes are called the exact same things in each entity, as this allows you to see exactly where the data comes from. It's also a good idea to add the name of the entity to keys. So for example, we've used dept ID instead of just ID, and that way you won't get confused later on. Finally, I just want to introduce the idea of optionality. In this example here, we have employees who work in departments. Those employees may have specific tasks to perform, but equally they may not have any tasks at all. Whether they have any tasks is completely optional, but how do we represent this fact on the diagram? Well, that's actually quite easy. We just use a dashed line to represent the relationship, but you only use dashes on the sides of the relationship which is optional. So in our example, it's optional as to whether the employee has a task or not, but tasks cannot be assigned to no one, so it's not optional for a task belonging to an employee. It's entirely possible for both halves of the relationship to be optional too, of course, in which case both halves of the line would be dashed.